KPFA Berkeley, 89.3 KPFB Berkeley, 88.1 KFCF Fresno, 97.5 K248BR Santa Cruz, and online at kpfa.org. The time is 9 p.m. Stay tuned for Suspense.
Tonight, we take pleasure in bringing you Suspense, a weekly anthology of notable melodramas from stage and screen, fiction and radio, presented each week to bring you to the edge of your chair, to keep you in suspense. During the 19th century, an unusually repugnant form of criminal activity was rampant throughout North America and Europe, grave robbing. Whether to supply doctors with cadavers for research purposes, or simply to pilfer the deceased's valuables, the practice became so commonplace that it spawned a cottage industry devoted to safeguarding burial sites by a variety of ingenious means. But it wasn't always humans that desecrated the resting places of the dead. Such was the case in Salem, Massachusetts, where one of the town's oldest cemeteries earned an especially unsavory reputation for its
invasive. Would invite us to begin the day. Something happened along the way. We used to be happy with Sam.
Something happened along the way.
And yesterday was all we had.
I must admit to reservations about the interment here of my beloved Mordecai.
Really, Mrs. Prynne?
Yes, really, Mr. Masson. I'll have you know that I have of late become privy to certain stories concerning this cemetery.
And what stories might they be, Mrs. Prynne?
Stories concerning the vast hordes of rats which frequent these grounds.
Nothing but old wives' tales. There's nary a rat to be found here.
I wish I could believe that, Mr. Masson, but the stories are quite widespread. How generations ago a colony of rats came up from the wharves and settled here in the graveyard. And how they became abnormally large, glutting upon the dead.
Not a word of truth to it.
And perhaps not just upon the dead, for I have also learned that your predecessor, God rest his soul, died here under most suspicious circumstances.
Now, he was an old codger anyway. Not to speak ill of the dead, mind you, but it was his time.
In fact, it would not be out of the question, Mr. Masson, for this graveyard to be closed down entirely due to its neglected condition.
Well...
Mr. Masson!
All right. I do apologize for withholding the truth from you, Mrs. Prynne, but I'm getting up there in years myself, and I'm afeard that if the cemetery closes, I'll end up in the poorhouse. And that's no place for a hard-working, God-fearing man to be.
So the stories are true?
I do the best I can. I've set traps for them, put poisoned food by their burrows, even tried shooting them. But the best I can do is keep them under control. I dare any man in Salem to do better.
And the stories of the rats desecrating the dead?
They're true. But I swear to you, on my own mother's grave, that no rat will disturb a hair on your beloved Mordecai's head.
Truly, Mr. Masson?
Cross me up, Mrs. Prynne. My men Simmons and I will stand watch over his grave every night if need be.
Well, I do thank you, Mr. Masson. I should like to compensate you for your additional efforts.
No, I wouldn't dream of it, Mrs. Prynne. Just doing our duty. Even though it will mean that young Simmons will be spending more time away from his wife and little ones.
Oh, dear. Really? In that case, I insist. Please, pass this along to Simmons as some measure of recompense for his family.
Ah, God bless you, Mrs. Prynne. I'm sure that young Simmons will be most grateful.
It's quite all right, Mr. Masson. Well, I really should be going before nightfall. Many thanks to you and Simmons for watching over my Mordecai.
'Tis my honor to do so, madam. Good day, Mrs. Prynne.
Good day, Mr. Masson.
You hear all that, Simmons?
Aye, every word. So, then this money must be mine, eh?
Tell you what. You conjure up a wife and kids, and it's all yours. In the meantime, I'll hold on to it. For safekeeping, of course.
Of course. So, what's on the docket for tonight?
Did you not hear? I made Mrs. Prynne a solemn vow to make sure that her beloved Mordecai is not disturbed by any rats. And what better way to prevent that than to disturb him ourselves?
Aye, 'tis the Christian thing to do.
We wait till 11 o'clock, just in case there are any late mourners.
I'll have spades and lanterns ready. Have a buyer for Prynne.
Oh, Doc Thurbert's always in need of fresh cadavers, so he'll take this one. No questions asked. Minus the gold fillings, of course.
I had a mouthful of them, and an especially fine set of cufflinks. Oh, and a genuine pearl stick pin.
Oh, you don't miss a thing, do you?
Well, when a fella has a wife and wee ones at home, then. Ah, sure hope those filthy little monsters haven't gotten to him already.
Aye, that'd be the third time this week.
Maybe they're undercutting us, eh? Taking the cadavers to the medical school themselves. Sorry.
We can't afford to lose this one, so put your back into it.
So, you know about how the rats came to this cemetery?
Aye. The rats have been here nigh as long as the graveyard itself. It said they came off of ships from distant ports with strange cargoes. Oh, they were big to start with and kept growing on account of having so many corpses to feed upon. And now, well, you've seen them yourself. Big as a full-sized alley cat, and twice as mean.
Aye, that they are. But it is not just their unnatural size that folks find, well, perplexing. Every time we open a grave, only to find that the rats have beat us to it, the coffin's always been gnawed open at the end. That's never the size, not even once. It's as if the little beasties just knew. Well, and why do they carry off the corpses, eh? Huh? Why not just feast on the rotting flesh right where it lay? It's as if some unseen hand guided their actions.
Do you hear yourself, you old woman? Some unseen hand. Next we'll be going on about there are worse things than rats crawling in the unhallowed earth beneath Salem. More abundant human creatures that still exist in forgotten burrows.
You shouldn't be so quick to laugh off that which you cannot explain.
And you shouldn't be so quick to lend credence to superstitious nonsense when there be rational explanations.
Oh, so just what are these rational explanations, then?
I'll have to wait, my boy. Let's clear the lid.
Wait. Do you hear that? That scratching.
The rats. They've beaten us to Prynne. Hurry, pry the lid. You have that pepper box pistol? We may be needing it.
I have it.
Hurry! Hurry! Blast it! Gone! Wait. Can you hear?
Aye. They have not gone far with our prize, but... Oh, to be so close.
We're not done yet, lad.
What?
We're going in after them.
Are you daft? Going crawling down into them warrens?
Oh, they've not gone far. We'll catch up with them in no time.
And then what? You've seen the size of him. There must be hundreds down there, ferocious little devils with mouths full of needle-sharp fangs, and you want us to go into their lairs?
They're just rats. They'll flee at the very sight of us.
Well, you can learn that for yourself, because there's no way I'm setting foot down there.
We're both going.
But how do we even know we'll fit?
Our rats have been dragging corpses through them tunnels for years. We'll fit. You go first, and take a lantern.
Oh, Lord, have mercy on a poor sinner. And slimy.
What did you expect with all the rain we've had?
And the stench, it's like carrion.
Quit your belly aching and keep moving.
Massive.
What now?
It ain't just the stench and the damp and the oversized rodents that have me spooked.
Now, here we go with the old wives' tales.
Look, you didn't grow up here in ancient witch-hunted Salem, but I did. And the tales me grandmother told me as a little shaver...
You'll be carrying on like a little shaver now.
Look, the old days, when Cotton Mather hunted down the colts that worshipped Hecate and the dark Magna Mater. And they're long past, but even today, blasphemous secrets are said to be hidden below the surface, where forgotten pagan rites are still celebrated in defiance of law and sanity.
No, not but superstitious blather.
Me gram told me of ghoulish beings that dwelt underground that had the power of commanding the rats, marshalling them like horrible armies.
Simmons.
They sent the rats abroad to carry messages and to rob graves.
Simmons.
The old fable of the Pied Piper, it hides a blasphemous truth.
Simmons.
Oh, Saints preserve us. The furrow's going to collapse.
Simmons, keep your voice down.
Listen, we've got to get out of here. Do you hear me? We've got to get out of here.
Get hold of yourself, man. We're almost caught up with the thieving little bastard.
No!
All right, all right. This... The burrow, it's too narrow to turn around in.
Oh, Lord. Oh, saints preserve us.
Hold on, hold on. Okay. We passed a couple of side tunnels already. Is there one anywhere ahead? Simmons. Simmons.
There's one just ahead on the left. Maybe 15 feet further.
Calm yourself, lad. Let's go forward a wee bit further, then we use that side tunnel to get ourselves turned back around.
All right.
Just keep your wits about you, Simmons. We'll be topside again before you know it.
If you say so, Nelson. If you say so.
Mm.
about there.
Good. Now you need to go a little farther straight ahead while I get myself reversed. Then all you do is crawl backwards a few feet and turn yourself around. We'll be out of here in no time.
Sure. Yeah, sure we will.
And set the lantern in the side tunnel as you pass. I'll be needing it to guide us back out of this hell maze.
Sure. Sure.
And just about in. Turning around now.
What the devil?
What? What's that?
I suppose the rats don't devour every last corpse they drag into these tunnels.
But there's one just a few feet ahead of me, all propped up like.
Masson, back out now.
Huh. Reckon it's been here for a while, too. Looks to be almost mummified.
Masson, back out now.
Wait, it's almost as if... as if the damn thing is moving.
Back out now! Now, back out!
It is moving.
Go! Get out of my way!
What is that?
It's one of those blasphemous things from the old stories. It's summoning its legions of rats. Hurry!
I'm being moved as fast as I can.
Oh, heavens. I can't let them get to me. I have to... Oh, ow!
My head. This big rock in the roof of the warren.
Oh, if I can dislodge it, maybe I can collapse the tunnel behind me and hold those monsters at bay till I get out. Almost there. Just one more. No! My lantern! Broken! Oh. It's black all around. And those minions of Elclaw on their way to get to me. Get a grip on yourself, Masson. The way out cannot be much further. Just feel your way along the wall, and you'll be above ground before you know it. Oh, but hurry, man. Hurry! Heaven, where be that blasted hole out of here?
No! Oh, no! Stay back!
Stay back! Stay back, damn you! I said stay back! Oh, leave me be! Leave me be! Ow! No!
Oh, sweet Jesus, please let me find that owl.
That's it. I found it. I found a way out of this hell.
Oh, God. I just need a little time. Collapse the entrance behind me. That'll keep the rats at bay long enough for me to get out. Oh, praise be to God. What the devil? The lid. Sealed. Wow. How? No. No. It is the wrong grave. I'm in the wrong grave. No! No! No!
The Graveyard Rats by John C. Alzadek and Dana Perry Hayes. Tonight's story of Suspense. Suspense is produced by Blue Hours Productions. Tonight's drama was adapted for radio by John C. Alzadek and Dana Perry Hayes from the short story by Henry Kuttner. Daamen Krall was Old Masson. Christopher Duva was Simmons. And Dana Perry Hayes was Mrs. Prynn. I'm Daamen Krall. Next week at this time, tune in again for another study in Suspense.
I'm John C. Alsadek.
And I'm Dana Perry Hayes. Together, we're Blue Hours Productions, the producers of Suspense. In this series of post-episode segments, we'll explain some of the inner workings of radio's outstanding theater of thrills. So please join us as we go behind Suspense. In this week's segment, we'll talk about suspense. No, not our revival. The original Suspense. The greatest anthology series ever broadcast on the airwaves.
In the early 1940s, dramatic programs concerning murder and the macabre were all the rage, with the likes of Lights Out, The Whistler, The Mysterious Traveler, and Inner Sanctum Mysteries drawing large audiences. But in 1942, CBS Radio premiered the program that was to become the gold standard for shows of this type, Suspense. Its story actually began during the summer of 1940, when a dry run of sorts ran on the summer series Forecast, an adaptation of The Lodger, starring Edmund Gwenn and Herbert Marshall, and directed by none other than Alfred Hitchcock.
This pilot episode was to set the tone for the series, which stood head and shoulders above its rivals in large part due to the sheer star power. Orson Welles and Agnes Moorehead starred in two of the earliest episodes, Lucille Fletcher's The Hitchhiker and Sorry, Wrong Number. And it wasn't long before Hollywood's elite performers were lining up to appear on Suspense. Over the next decade, the show would feature the likes of Humphrey Bogart, Marlena Dietrich, Judy Garland, Gene Kelly, Jimmy Stewart, and dozens of others, including horror legends Boris Karloff, Bela Lugosi, and Vincent Price. It also provided an unusual opportunity for radio stars better known as comedic actors such as Jack Benny and Lucille Ball to try their hand at darker fare. Combined with sophisticated stories by the likes of Dashiell Hammett, Agatha Christie, and frequent contributor John Dixon Carr, and the atmospheric music of Oscar winner Bernard Herrmann, Suspense was a cut above in every way.
Unfortunately, the advent of television spelled doom for Suspense, and though it outlasted most of its peers by 10 years or more, Suspense finally went off the air in 1962. An event that is commonly considered the end of radio's golden age. Radio anthologies made a brief comeback in the 1970s via Rod Serling's Zero Hour and the fondly remembered CBS Radio Mystery Theater. But even those fine programs were only a shadow of what Suspense had once been.
Thank you for joining us on Behind Suspense. Until next time, this is Blue Hours Productions wishing you good night
and pleasant dreams.
In our peculiar new landscape, increasingly irrational, hostile to science, sneering at the environment, it is profoundly reassuring to see Richard Dawkins step forth with a new book, Science in the Soul, selected writings of a passionate rationalist. The English biologist, author of The Selfish Gene, The God Delusion, and Brief Candle in the Dark, Dawkins now makes a stunning defense of science, of clear thinking, and the sacred truth of nature. He'll appear with KPFA host Philip Maldery on Wednesday, August 9th at 7:30 p.m. at First Congregational Church of Berkeley, 2345 Channing Street. There is wheelchair access. Tickets available at the best bookstores as well as brownpapertickets.com. For clarity, for refreshing hopefulness, on August 9th, join Richard Dawkins.
George Orwell's novel, 1984, was written as a warning. He would be shocked to know that many of his fictional horrors are being realized today. KPFA and Pacifica will air a 15-hour marathon broadcast of 1984 on Tuesday, June 27th, for the first time since the original broadcast in 1975. The classic cover-to-cover reading is by blacklisted writer Charles Morgan and legendary voiceover artist June Foray. Join us Tuesday, June 27th, beginning at 6 a.m. for an all-day national